Hi class, so today we're going to talk about documentary film, sort of my specialty. And sort of the first documentary film was a film called Nanook of the North. And what happened in Nanook is the director, Robert Flaherty, he went and he filmed an entire tribe of people, the Inuit Indians. And when he went to edit it then, cigarette burned up the film because celluloid is highly combustible. And so he had to go back and film again. But this time, instead of filming the whole tribe, he just filmed one person, Nanook. And by telling Nanook's story, he tells the story of the entire people. And so that's kind of a key aspect of documentary film that's still very much alive today, is that you just pick one person, you tell that person's story, and then that person's story represents a larger idea. So as you watch this clip, ask yourself if something seems off. And so this is just Nanook in his everyday life. So why I showed that is because what I wanted you to see is that clearly that scene was set up, right? They didn't just happen to be filming when they pulled up with the canoe and everyone was sort of in it like that. So at the very beginning of documentary film, because most of you probably think of documentary that you're watching the truth, but what you're really just watching is you're watching one director's interpretation of the truth. And oftentimes there will be things that are set up in the film. The director Werner Herzog has said that he really doesn't see a distinction between his narrative fiction films and his documentaries. And I would tend to agree. The more you understand the editing process and how documentaries are produced, the more skeptical you become of whether or not you're actually watching the truth. So before digital cameras came around, when you had to make films on celluloid, it was really expensive. A 400-foot roll of film, which when run through a camera, lasts about 11 minutes and 38 seconds, cost $400. and then you cost about $400 to process it, and then you get it transferred to digital. So you're talking about for 11 minutes, at least $1,000 of cost per 11 minutes, versus these little SD cards that you can put into a digital camera and will just run forever. And that's why you're seeing so many documentary films being produced now than there were before. So before digital cameras, you pretty much had to get like a grant from the National Endowment of the Arts in order to make a documentary. And you had sort of titles like Gap-Tooth Women being produced. So this would be a film by a documentary filmmaker named Les Blank, who I've actually met before. But the subject matter is just women who have gap teeth. And this is kind of the documentaries you would see in sort of the 70s and the 80s.
When I was little, I had three younger brothers that I would babysit a lot. And when my parents were away, if we'd sneak back in the cupboard and take a bite out of a candy bar or any other forbidden cookies or cakes or whatever, my parents always knew when I had done it. And I thought they were so magic and all-knowing until I caught on that they were recognizing my signature, which was my teeth marks on the food, you know.
Third generation with a gap?
I guess so. I think her mother had it, and she had it. She had braces when she was younger.
My father has a gap about as wide as mine is. My mom has a gap a little smaller.
Everybody in my family has it, the women in my family.
People think somehow that there's a mystique about Asian women, Hawaiian women, Korean women, Japanese women, and I'm just wondering if people don't think there's some mystique about gap teeth women. I mean, I read somewhere in a folklore book, and I really feel stupid saying this, that gap-teeth women are supposed to be sexier. It's like this mound of Venus stuff. If you have a big, thick mound of Venus, you're supposed to be real hot stuff or something. And I guess it's the same thing with gap teeth.
That just gives you an idea of early documentary, especially before digital cameras. Triumph of the Will, this is directed by Leni Riefenstahl, and she was Hitler's chief propagandist. So she's famous for this film, as well as in a film called Olympiad. And she went to jail after World War II, but eventually she was released and sort of went on to live a rather remarkable life, but I just wanted to show you some shots of Triumph of the Will and how it was done.
Triumph of the Will, directed by Leni Riefenstahl, is a film.
Cut the audio on that. Just pay attention to the camera angles, because it was mostly silent, but she was really innovative in her camera angles and moving the camera and having sort of dolly shots and things like this before other people were using it. Notice how she frames Hitler sort of in the center, kind of like classicism, right? How Socrates was framed. And this is just a little short film on a documentary called The Life, The Wonderful Horrible Life of Leni Riefenstahl, that sort of talks about who she was, how she became Hitler's propagandists and what happened to her life afterwards. This is just like a trailer. Flip side of that, there's Leni Riefenstahl, a film called Night and Fog. This is about the concentration camps. This clip is too long for us to watch the whole thing, but do watch the whole thing. I'll have the link ready for you. You might have to sign in for age appropriateness. It's only 3 minutes. Maybe we'll watch the whole thing. Kind of shows you the power of documentary film, that how it can be used for good or evil.
Sur le camp. C'est une autre planète. Sous son prétexte hygiénique, la nudité du premier coup livre au camp l'homme déjà humilié, rasé, tatoué, numéroté, pris dans le jeu d'une hiérarchie encore incompréhensible, revêtu de la tenue bleue rayée, classé parfois Nacht und Nebel, nuit et brouillard. Marqué du triangle rouge des politiques, le déporté affronte d'abord les triangles verts, les droits communs, maître parmi les accords, les latrines, les apportes. Des squelettes au ventre de bébé, il venait 7 fois, 8 fois par nuit. La soupe était diurétique. Malheur à celui qui rencontrait un capot ivre au clair de lune. On s'y observait avec crainte. On y guettait des symptômes bientôt familiers. Faire du sang, c'était signe de mort. Marché clandestin, on y vendait, on y achetait, on y tuait en doute. On s'y rendait visite. On se passait les vraies et les fausses nouvelles. On y organisait des groupes de résistance. Une société y prenait forme. Une forme sculptée dans la terreur, moins folle pourtant que l'ordre des SS qui s'exprimait par ses préceptes. La propreté, c'est la santé. Le travail, c'est la liberté. À chacun son dû. Tout est prétexte à facétie, à punition, à humiliation. Les appels durent des heures.
So that's just an excerpt from the film. It's about 27 minutes long. Roger means cinema verite. So cinema verite means that the director makes himself a part of the film. It's not to be confused with direct cinema, where in direct cinema, it's like the fly on the wall. The director is not seen. So Roger Me, this was really the film in 1989 that was watershed for documentary film, in that Michael Moore found a way to make it entertaining. It's a serious subject matter, but in many ways it's a comedy. And he just found a way of breaking it through and sort of merging documentary film with entertainment. That's kind of what he did so well. But again, he's putting himself into the film, so it's cinema verite. In this particular scene, you're going to see a rabbit get skinned alive, so just skip ahead if you don't want to watch that. But ask yourself, why is this in this film? So in this film, Roger, Michael Moore, he went away to California from Flint, Michigan, his hometown, to be an editor of this magazine. Eventually, he comes back, and Flint, Michigan, which had been a really wealthy area because of the auto industry. The auto industry had left towards Mexico, and it had sort of devastated the community. And Michael Moore is trying to get an interview with the then CEO of the company, and he is attempting to. But in this particular scene, he's going to talk to a woman who, because she's so poor, she needs to sell rabbits just unable to survive. And as you're watching it, think, why is this scene about a rabbit getting skinned in this film, about the destruction of Flint via the auto industry? Notice it's entitled The Infamous Flint Rabbit.
And told me that I was, well, I said my rabbit meat usually went. Doing my rabbits in an unsanitary condition for dressing them. So now I have to build me a building where there's washable walls, washable floors, and an unbreakable light. I have to have a scale that weighs properly. And I have to have three sinks where I dress the rabbits.
What's going to happen to him?
He's going to be eaten. It'll be our supper on the supper table. Doesn't matter, huh? What are you guys crying about?
How do you slaughter them?
Hung them upside down and stripped the fur off. And gutted them. Quit biting. And chopped their heads off. Quit it.
What happened to your brother who was working at the factory?
He got laid off. Now you know what I'm talking about. You're dripping. My girlfriend out in Fenton, we tan them, and we try to make coats and gloves and animals out of the furs.
What kind of coat does rabbit fur make?
A rabbit coat. What else do you think it makes?
Is it a nice coat? Is it warm?
I don't know. We ain't made one yet. We got to get enough furs.
How many do you need?
A lot. You need lots and lots and lots of furs. And right now, we've only got 135 furs. Is all the rabbits I've done so far before I got in trouble. That's why I'm not actually supposed to be doing this. I was brought up to learn to survive if you were out in the wilderness. Now I'm getting ready to gutting.
Do you think it's hard to survive in Flint these days?
Yes.
Why?
Well, the shops are all going down and people just ain't got the money like they used to anymore and can't be buying things and...
So again, why is this scene in the film? Well, you notice when he asked, just before she clobbered the rabbit, he said, what happened to your brother at the factory? And her response was, he got laid off. And then you hear the metal pipe hit. So it's a metaphor. So this is what GM is doing to Flint, what she did to the rabbit. So that's sort of the idea. So that would be cinema verite, as opposed to direct cinema, where the director is just a fly on the wall and doesn't put himself into the film. So this is about, it started off as a concert film for the Rolling Stones, and it was going to end at this, what was supposed to be the second Woodstock, where there was a free concert in Altamont, California. And what happened was, the Rolling Stones got the Hell's Angels motorcycle gang to be security at this event, and they paid them in free beer. And so you can imagine how this went. Eventually, things get out of hand, and someone gets killed during the event. I'll show you some of the clip, and then I'm going to fast forward because I want you to see the end, what happens at the end of this. See the scuffle. That guy just got stabbed.
And then look, we're splitting. You know, if those cats, if you people, we're splitting, man. If those cats don't stop beating everybody up inside, I want them out of the way, man. I don't like you.
Hey, people. Hey, people, come on, let's be cool. People, please, there's no reason to hassle anybody. Please don't commit it.
If you move back and sit down, we can continue, and we will continue.
Can you roll back on that, David?
So I want to push ahead towards the ending of this.
Thank you.
So why end a concert film like that? You know, you have these shots of people, they look like nomads, sort of look like they're lost, right? They don't know what they're doing. Well, that's kind of the point, because remember, it was supposed to be the second Woodstock, this event, and a murder ended up taking place. And so it was kind of like the idea, like the 60s was that, you know, all you needed was peace and love and the world was going to be a great place. And instead, someone gets killed, and it's like the dawning of that realization that that idea is dead. And so, in a way, this film has captured sort of the end of that 60s ideal, and that's sort of why it's such a remarkable piece. If you have any other questions on documentary film, feel free to email me.